Thank God for each and every one of you that he has kept you. He fought your battles this week. I don't see nobody starving up in here. So everybody is okay. Amen. Just look to your left and say, God bless you. Good to see you. To your left. That's your left hand right here, in case you don't know. This is your left. Glory be to God. Now look to your right and say, God bless you. It's good to see you. Now speak to yourself and say, God got a word for me today. And I want to receive it. Not just receive it. I'm going to act upon it. In Jesus' name. Now give God some glory. Give God some glory. Give God some glory. My God. There's an anonymous quote that says, it's not what you are that hinders you. It's what you think you are not. An amazing quote. It's what you are that's not hindering you. It's what you think you are not. And we'll understand that in a few minutes. Amen? God has given me a word for his people today. You know, even in the midst of all that God has done, doing in our lives, there's still some, not all, but some, who really, their self-esteem is really low. It's really low. They're blaming everything for the reasons, for the predicament that they are in right now. They're blaming everything for the predicament that they are in. They can't see how great they are in the sight of God because the situations of life have beat them up so much that there are some of God's children who really believe this is their lot in life. There's nothing else. There's nothing else. And that is not so. So God has given the word. But before I give the word, I just want every saint to remember the family of the Beards who lost a loved one and the family of the Bivens who lost a loved one. Amen. I want you to keep them in prayer. Glory be to God. I want you all to specifically raise up Brianna's name before the Lord continually. Continually. Those of us that are adults in here that have been around for a while know what it's like to lose a mom. Amen? Know what it's like. She's only 14 years old. She's only 14. Glory be to God. So keep Brianna's name up in prayer. Please. Every time you think about her, pray for her. Pray for her. Glory to God. But we thank God he's a merciful God. The word declares that when mama and father forsake you, he will pick you up. Amen. He will pick you up. And I believe God without a shadow of a doubt. I believe him. This is a two-part scripture here today, if you don't mind. If you do mind, too bad. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 6 to 9. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 6 to 9. That if you keep your finger there, you go over to 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. That's Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 6 to 9. And then keep your finger there and go over to 1 Peter chapter 2. Verses 9 and 10. Father, we want to thank you today and give you the glory and give you the honor and give you the praise. We want to bless your name, my God, because you are our God, our Lord, and our Savior. You are our Redeemer, our soon coming King. You are the Holy One, the Blessed One. We want to thank you, my God, for the mercy that you have extended to us one more time. We thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. We want to thank you for thy long suffering, Father. We want to thank you, my God, just for the opportunity to be in your house one more time. We want to thank you that your spirit is here, Father, and we bless your name. We want to thank you for this word, my God, and we stand on your word. It declares that your word goes forth and it accomplishes that which you please. So we want to thank you in advance, my God, for all that's going to be accomplished. Thank you for lifting up hung down heads, healing, delivering, and setting free. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 6 to 9. Everybody there? If not, say, wait up. Amen. And it reads as follows, verse 6. For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God has chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. The Lord did not set his love upon you nor choose you because you were more in number than any people, for ye were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loves you, and because he would keep the oath which he swore unto your fathers, has the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondsmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, who keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. Now, if you please just turn over to my God, Peter, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. Amen. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. So far the reading of the blessed word. Just want to talk to you for a moment that you are special in his sight. You are, may be seated, you are special in his sight. I started off by just telling you, glory be to God, about the quote that many people don't realize, especially God's children, who you are. Who you are, especially in the Lord. And that verse that he gave me to start with was 1 Peter chapter 2 and 9. And he says four distinct things there. He says you are number one, chosen. Number two, of a royal priesthood. Number three, a holy nation. And a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. So just reading that verse by itself gives you a clear indication why you should praise God. Amen? Amen. Why? Because you are chosen, you are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, and a peculiar people. Now, I understand that peculiar part. Yes, some saints are peculiar, but not the way God means it. That is not the way God means it here with this, in this text. Sometimes we take that peculiar people meaning the way they act, and that is not what God is talking about. But first he said that you are a chosen people. Chosen, that means having been selected as the best or the most appropriate. Chosen. You were selected as the best or the most appropriate. And who chose you? God. God chose you. I don't know how we see ourselves, but God said when he chose you for a reason. He didn't choose you or I to walk around with a hung down head. He didn't choose you or I to walk around with low self-esteem and bad attitude, thinking everybody is better than you. That is not so. That is not the reason why he chose you. My God. Deuteronomy 14 and 2 tells us quite clearly, again, you are a holy people unto the God, unto the Lord thy God. And the Lord has chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself above all the nations that are upon the earth. So that means quite clearly, he says that word peculiar again and holy. Deuteronomy 14 and 2. Letting you know that you are different than other people. Amen. There's nobody like you. But the problem is, there's too many of God's children trying to be like somebody else. You're not satisfied with who you are, so you want to be somebody else. But you do not realize, nor do you understand, that person that you're trying to imitate or emulate, my God, they had to go through a lot to be where they are now. Amen? You don't know what they went through or how they had to go through in order to be where they are. All we see them now, but glory be to even those people that you see on TV, the rap artists, the ball players, the people that you see on TV, you only see in the physical structure, but you don't know what happens behind closed doors. You don't understand their lifestyle. All you see is a facade. You don't see what they have to go through when they go behind that closed door, when the camera is cut off. But you want to be like them instead of being like the one that God has made you to be. You are the best that you could ever be. No one ever, could ever be like you. No, no one could ever be like you. And it's a slap in God's face when you try to be like somebody else. You're actually slapping him in his face, saying, God, you don't know what you're doing. Why didn't you make me like her? Why didn't you make me like him? How come I'm not standing behind this desk? Really? Do you know what it took to stand behind this desk? Do you know what I had to give up to stand behind this desk? Do you know how? Oh, God. Well, anyway. But sometimes we just ain't satisfied with being with who we are. Oh, I can sing like them. How come I'm not there? That's a good question. Why are you not there if you can sing? Maybe your singing sounds good in the shower, because mine does. When you're in the shower, I can hit a note, Jack. And I sound good to me. Not being there. Washing or shaving, just singing to myself. Glory to God. But when I step out of that shower, still be singing, I say, oh, Lord, let me stop that. All right. So chosen, God has chose you, but he also chose you as a holy people. Holy, this is what he says, amen? And according to Ephesians, glory be to God, he tells us that, Ephesians 1 and 4, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love. Ephesians 1 and 4. So before the foundation of the world, God has chosen you to be holy. And we're going to get into that in a minute. I'm just going to give you a little foundation right now. Amen? That word holy, holy. To God you are holy. And that's important. To God you are holy. What is meant by the word holy? How is it translated? Holy means to be sacred, morally blameless, consecrated, a saint. That's what holy is. God is looking for some people who are consecrated or set apart for his use. And he knows who those holy ones should be because he chose them. Wow. So now God is looking for a holy people. He's not saying for you and I to try to make ourselves holy. He says he already chose you because you know you can be holy. Ephesians 1 and 4. It was predestined before the foundation of the world. That's not for us to walk around, glory be to God, with a Bible on top of our head and think that I'm better than you because you are not. It's not for us to walk around popping scripture five times, every time. I can't even say hello to you before you start giving me scripture. I am so sorry, but I have met too many people of God that cannot hold a decent conversation without popping scripture at me. If I ask you, what was the score of the game last night? Oh, but you know Jesus was at the ball game. I didn't ask you that.
We walk around in this flesh, do we not? And we can have a decent conversation with, right? Can we not do that? A holy conversation. I went to lunch the other day with an apostle and another bishop, and we sat down and we had a conversation, and we wasn't popping scripture. We were just talking about life. Talking about life and how life is treating you and how you should deal with life and some of the things that they go through and the things that I'm going through. But we have to know that God has chosen us to be a holy people, holy unto Him. We are holy to God. And we are called for His purpose. 2 Timothy 1:9, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. 2 Timothy 1:9. So God has chosen us for a purpose, to be holy before Him, to give off praises to Him, to glory be to God, to get that we He can get the glory out of our lives. And why did God do this? 1 Peter 1:15-16. I'm going to get into the text. 1 Peter 1:15-16 says, "But as He which has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, Be ye holy, for I am holy." 1 Peter 1:15-16. Meaning we are responsible to carry ourselves in a way that gives God the glory. Amen? That's what that means. That our conversation should be such that should be morally correct. Amen? That we should carry ourselves in such a way that God gets the glory out of our lives. That's why God has chosen us. And He has given us the ability to do it, because the Word says He, before the foundation of the world, He predestined that we should be holy. So that means God has already given you and I the ability to walk before Him in holiness. Consecrate ourselves. Sacred. Saints. That's what the word, that word holy. To walk before Him like that. And not just before Him, but before other people. Amen? Again, He is not calling us. He is not calling us to walk around and think that we are better than people. Because, you know, just for a little bit, we could have been homeless. Just for a little bit. Just for a little bit. Just for a little bit. If it wasn't for God's mercy, where would you and I be? If it wasn't for His mercy, where would you and I be? When we see them people on the street, my God, laying out there on the street, stupefied. Amen? Everybody that's on the street is not a fool. There are some educated college people out there that the vicissitudes of life, the problems of life that hit them so hard, glory be to God, that they have lost everything. Everything. You think they want to be on the street? Out there with a master's degree, do you think they want to be out there? No, they don't. But they have no other choice. Oh, but the mercy of God. The mercy of God has kept us from that. I don't know how close you have been to that, my God, where you almost lost everything. I don't know how close you ever been to that, my God, where everything almost was taken away from you. Almost. If it was not for God, you would have lost it. Oh, but the mercy of God. Oh, God, but there goes I. You don't know about that woman or that man that's walking through the trash can by McDonald's just looking for a sandwich, looking for food that's been thrown out there, or going behind the supermarket and getting some of that old bread. And we look at it and we kind of shrug. But by the mercy of God, that could have been us. Oh, but the mercy of God. But he has predestined, just like he predestined some of them. He has chosen some of them. I believe some of the best preachers is going to be with those that come off of that street, that have had the hard knocks, that understand what it is to be destitute, what it means to be hungry, what it means to be doing without, and are satisfied with eating a can of pork and beans. Some of God's children frown on that kind of stuff. But if you've never been there, you know how to appreciate it when you get it. Yeah, I told you before, I continue to tell you, there's some people, glory be to God, who frown on the end of the bread. I eat the end. I eat the end. Both of them, the one on top and the one on the bottom. And that peanut butter and jelly tastes just as good with the ends as it does with the bread in the middle. And it makes the best toast. Yeah. Yeah, it's the best part. I know there's some take their bread and give it to the birds. Well, I'm the bird. Give it to me. Because I've been there when I didn't have it all. I've been there when I cherished that end of the bread. Glory to God. How we get on that, Lord? I don't know. Jesus. Shout out. Oh, my God. Oh, when you just think about where God has brought you from and how much he has kept you from, the things that he has shielded you from. When he says, I am your rear guard and your shield and your buckler, I am a shield unto you. That means he has shielded you from some things that, my God, that was meant to do you harm. You have not felt the full devastation, my God, of the things that you have went and I have went through. He has kept back a lot from us. Glory to God. I'm over here, Lord Jesus. Okay. My God. Shout out of bullshit. Ah, but the mercy of God. He has chosen. Before the foundation of the world, for us to be holy and do certain things, which I'm going to get to in a minute, the Holy Spirit allows. He has chosen us. But how do we see ourselves? Do we see ourselves as nothing? Do we see ourselves as just being cast away? Huh? We don't see nothing in life, my God? This is my plot in life. This is all for me in life. I'm going to suffer all of my life. I'm going to be without all of my life. I'm going to be living in this place all of my life. I'm never going to have nothing all of my life. My mother was like this. My father was like this. My grandparents was like this. I guess I'm going to be like this too. How do you see yourself? Do you see yourself as being that chosen and that holy one of God? Or do you see yourself as just plain Jane? Glory be to God. So in the text, in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 7, glory to God, here's God talking to Israel, and he's giving them some specific instructions. He says, when I get ready to take you, glory be to God, into the land that I swore to give unto you. When I take you there, there's some things that I have to do first. There's some things that I have to do. Glory be to God. And he says this quite clearly in verse number 1, and I love this. He says that when I take you into the land that you're going to possess, and I, meaning God, has cast out the nations before you, I'm going to cast out the Hittites and the Gergesites and the Amorites and the Canaanites, and the Persiarites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, seven nations. Seven. That's important. Completion. When I cast them out, this is what God is telling them. When I put you in, I'm going to fight your battle for you. I'm going to fight your battle. I'm going to cast them out. But he says this, as I'm fighting your battle and I give them into your hands, this is what I want you to do for them. I don't want you to show them no mercy. Saints, you don't give the devil no mercy. He don't like you. He don't like me. He don't like God's children. I don't know why you're pampering him. Glory be to God. Why you're playing with him. God says, when I give him to you, I want you to slaughter them, put them under feet. What I want you to do, I want you to take down their altars. I want you to burn their groves. I want you to, my God, take away every remembrance of them. Every remembrance. I don't want you to leave nothing undone. I don't want you to give your sons to their daughters. I don't want you to take their daughters to your sons, because that's going to cause them to turn away from me and serve an idol God. I want you, glory be to God, to take control of what I give you. And this is what God is telling us today. He wants you to take control of what he has given you. Stop sharing your stuff with the devil. Stop it. Oh, honey, it's all right. No, it's not all right. It's not all right. If God has given you something, you are to cherish it. Because God gave it to you. Why do you think he said? We see in Corinthians about being unequally yoked. But this is what he's saying right here. This is what God is telling them. Do not give your sons to their daughters. And don't allow your sons to take their daughters. Because the woman, and this is no reflection upon women, because the woman will turn a man's head in the wrong direction. I ain't heard nothing. A woman has a way of turning a man's head in the wrong direction. A woman will turn a man's head in the wrong direction. He will cause the man to start serving the heathen god. Didn't say the woman, it said the man. Oh, Jesus. I could just stay there for a while, but I think not. Because I just feel a little something. Feel a little something starting to pop off in my spirit, Jesus, about the woman can turn the man's head in the wrong direction. He's talking to us married men already, but thank God us married men have already married a Christian woman, amen? But that does not mean that a Christian woman can't turn the man's head when she wants attention or she wants something. Amen? Married men, you're in here? Huh? Well, y'all ain't saying nothing because you're next to your wife. Sam can talk, his wife ain't over there. Y'all ought to be ashamed of yourselves. You really should. Tell the truth, shame the devil. Now, you know, you women, you know when you want something from your hubby, you know exactly what to do. It ain't all the time you have to be sex. You know what to say and how to do it. Yeah, fix him this meal, the best meal. I can always tell when she's up to something. I got that great big bowl of banana pudding that only she can make. She don't put no slip in there with a note saying what she wants. I can always tell her something. Something's on the agenda. But God is telling Israel, let me come back to bring myself back. He's telling them, be careful what you do. Be careful. Be careful. But he says, I'm going to give you these enemies. I'm going to give them to you. But it's up to you to do your due diligence, to put them in defeat. Don't give them no leeway. Don't give them an opportunity, glory to God, to turn your head. I have given them to you, all seven of them. I have given them. And then he goes on to tell them, because you are a holy people. You are a holy people. And I gave you the instructions about holy before, and I told you I was going to come back to it. You are a holy people. You have to understand something about your holiness. Because God tells them in Deuteronomy chapter 9, verses 1 to 6, he makes it very clear about the holiness. He leaves no shadow of doubt about the holiness and why he chose them. Deuteronomy chapter 9, verse 1 to 6. But the last verse of number 6, God says, I didn't choose you because you were so righteous. I chose you because you are a stiff-necked people. Read it for yourself. He said, I didn't choose you because it was all about you. I can't make it without you. Because quite clearly, you are a stiff-necked people. But because of the promises that I made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I'm going to keep my word to you. Because you are a stiff-necked people. And now do you think, in your vain imagination, that that was only for them and not for us? You think God didn't know that we are a stiff-necked people? You think God don't know that many times we do what we want to do, when we want to do, and how we want to do, and expect God to bless it? Don't you think God understands that we were going to go south, but he says go north? Don't you think God knew us before we did it? But because he selected you, and because he chose you, and because he is honoring, glory to God, some prayers that your grandma prayed, that your grandfather prayed, somebody in your generational line prayed for you. Lord, I was talking to someone on the phone the other day. Yesterday. Was it yesterday? Yesterday. On the phone. Aunt Zell. She said, Eddie, my God, Whaley will be proud of you. That was my grandmother. Because Whaley never stopped talking, praying for your brother and you. She never saw me get saved. She died back there in 1965. She never saw the fruition of her prayer being answered. But the word declares the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. Glory be to God. She died, she transitioned, but God honored her prayer. So somebody in your line prayed for you. Somebody, you may not even know who they are. They prayed for you. They prayed. They prayed. And because God honored it, and because the person that prayed was a holy person that knew how to get to God, my God, their prayers didn't hit the ceiling and bounce back. God heard the prayer. God honored the prayer. The person has already transitioned, but God heard the prayer, and you're saved today. But God also says, glory be to God, it's not because of your righteousness, it's because you are stiff-necked people. But I'm a long-suffering God. I'm a long-suffering God. I put up with your stuff. Why? Because he told you, because I loved you. Because I love you. And that kind of love covers what? A multitude of sins. Some of us are very short-tempered. You wrong me today, I'm going to hold you for about 4 or 5 months. I'm going to hold you. As a matter of fact, I do declare, there are some people right now sitting right in here in Greater Zion that are still holding people from the old church. And we've been in here, what, almost 20 years? Still holding from a word that was spoken to them in the old church. Then they wonder why they can't move forward in their life. Then they wonder why their body has been neglecting them. Because you need to forgive. You need to let it loose. I am not talking about something manifested in my mind. I'm talking the truth that I know. You can't walk around holding people. They walking around skipping a loop and having a good time, and you making yourself ill. They're not even thinking about you. They don't care about you. You keeping their name, glory be to God, alive. So you are giving avenue to the adversary, the very one that God says for you to put underfoot. And a lot of that adversary is unforgiveness. You have allowed it to be alive in you. Oh. But Deuteronomy chapter 9, beautiful verses 1 to 6. I love it. God says, I didn't. Because you were so righteous. You were so holy. No, that ain't it. Because I know who you are. You are a stiff-necked people. But because of the promises that I made to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob, glory to God, I'm going to honor you. Deuteronomy 7, verses 8 and 9 says, but because the Lord loves you, and because he would keep his oath, which he had sworn unto your fathers, has the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand, and has redeemed you out of the house of bondsmen, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. That 1,000 generations is symbolic of eternity. He keeps his covenant for eternity. The Lord your God, he is God. He is the faithful God. That's this entire statement which says, glory be to God, which means that Jehovah, the eternal God, he is your Elohim, the creator God. He is the Elohim, creator God, the faithful El, the almighty, the strong God. That's what that last verse says. That means, glory be to God, when it says that he is God. That means he is the faithful God. He is Elohim, the creator God. He is El, which means the almighty, the strong one, the faithful God, the faithful God. Because he is faithful, that's why he kept his promises. This is why he watches over you and I when we sometimes act up. Because he loved us, and because he chose us, glory be to God. And he sees in us that things that we don't even see in ourselves. Really. Have any of you, are you still in the same spot now that you was 5 years ago? Have you seen yourself increase? Huh? Anybody in here see yourself in a place that you never thought you was going to be in? Now, I am not talking about a negative situation. Oh, I never thought I was going to be in this kind of a situation. I'm talking about something that God has done for you that you never thought that you would see it. Something that you really, has God ever blessed you and you didn't even ask for it? He just gave it to you. Why? Because he chose you. He chose you. And he delights in blessing you. And as we get to Peter, I'll show you something. But he delights in doing these things for his children. He wants to bless his children. He wants to bless you. He wants to, my God, see you increase. He wants to see these things. Why? Because he chose you. He chose you. You are unique. You are special people. You are special people. Psalms 139, verses 13 and 14. You know this scripture. For thou hast prospered my reins. Thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. My God, marvelous are thy works. And that my soul knoweth right well, because you are special. But the psalmist says, my soul knows it right well. Do you know, does your soul know, does your soul understand that you are marvelously and wonderfully made? Does your soul know this? Is it in your spirit to understand that God made you? My God, you are a unique person. There is nobody like you. Nobody has your fingerprints. Nobody has your footprints. You are unique in this world. When you transition, that is it. No more. End of the game. Go story over. But while you are on this earth, you have to understand, your soul has to understand that God made you unique and you are marvelously made. You are wonderfully made. You are special in the sight of God. You are special. God will never leave you nor forsake you. He will never leave his creation, and he created you before you was formed in your mother's womb. The word says God knew you. Didn't say he knew your mama or your daddy. Said he knew you before you was even formed. And then it goes on to say that he covered your comely parts. He covered those things that you don't want nobody to see, but he sees. Glory to God. So Peter picks this up. We see centuries later now. Here Peter is quoting the same thing that's been quoted in the Old Testament. The same wording that was quoted in the Old Testament. Here Peter is quoting the same thing. He's talking to those tribes that were scattered. And he's trying to, glory be to God, encourage them now. That's why this word come to us, to encourage us. It encouraged me when I was studying it. Because sometimes when things are going on in your life, you forget how special you are. And this is not having pride. This is what God says who I am. God says I'm special, I'm saying I'm special. God saying I'm unique, I'm saying I'm unique. God says I'm holy in his sight, I'm holy in his sight. If God said it, I'm in agreement. I'm in agreement. You're going to have to learn how to encourage yourself. The word says quite clearly that we are responsible to sing psalms to ourselves, encourage ourselves. My God, when nobody wants to encourage you, you should be able to encourage yourself. You should be able to encourage yourself, knowing how special you are, knowing that God made you. He made you unique. No one got to come pat you on the back and say you special. You should know you special. You should get in the mirror in your house or in the bathroom and talk to that mirror. Hey, I'm a special person. I am special in God's sight. I am marvelously and wonderfully made. There is nobody like me. I am unique. I am dynamite. Look out for me. Glory to God. Encourage yourself. Encourage yourself. Encourage yourself. Glory to God. Know who you are. Know who you are. So Peter picks it right back up. He said that you are chosen. Royal priesthood. That royal priesthood, if you go to Exodus chapter 19, I believe it is. Yeah, chapter 19, verse number 6. God says, you are a priest of many kingdoms. Glory be to God. You are a priest of the kingdoms. Now, a priest of a kingdom, glory be to God, is not no jive prince, priest. Amen? That means you are special. Royal priesthood. Holy nation. A peculiar person. That peculiar, glory be to God, peculiar, does not mean that you act kind of strange. That peculiar does not mean you walk around just doing strange stuff. That peculiar means that you have been purchased. You have been purchased. Glory be to God. It means that you're not peculiar. You're not peculiar in your dress or your speech or your manner of life. You are peculiar because you have been purchased. That's what peculiar means. If you look it up, my God, you'll see it in the Strohs. It means purchase. You were bought. You were bought with a price that you couldn't pay. You were bought, glory be to God, by Jesus Christ. By the blood of Jesus Christ, he bought you. You are peculiar, my God. You are peculiar. And you have received him as your Lord and as your Savior. You are peculiar. Peculiar. Glory be to God. You have been called for all of these things. chosen, priesthood, holy and peculiar. Why? To show forth the praises. To show forth the praises of him who calls you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Why did he do these four things? Why does he call us these four things? That we could show forth the praises to him. Amen? The praises. Those of us who were called out of darkness. Were you called out of darkness here? Was anybody happy where they were before Jesus came? Were you just dancing for joy? Or was you crying out, God, help me? Was you crying out, God, help me? And God hearkened unto your voice. Glory be to God. And he translated you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Why? Because the light and the dark are the same to God. My God, he saw you in your plight. He kept you for many years in darkness. He kept you many years in darkness, mainly because you wasn't crying out to him from your heart. You was only crying out because you was in trouble and you wanted to get out of trouble. And you made a promise to God, God, if you just get me out of this, I am going to do this. And God got you out of that and you didn't keep your vow.
Wow. Oh, Jesus.
I was guilty of that. Am I the only one in here? God, if you just get me out of this, just get me out of this. Make a way for me. Wasn't serving him. Didn't care nothing about Jesus. I was just in trouble. And all the help that I was relying on failed me. So I said, God, if you would just get me out of this, I will do this. And God, in his grace and his mercy, got me out of that. And I turned my back on the vow that I gave to him. But years later, he reminded me of my vow. You might have forgotten your vows, but God has not forgotten.
I see some hung down heads right now. The vow's coming back to you, isn't it?
Just say, God, I'm sorry. Just say, God, I repent. This is your moment now. God has spoken. Now it's just your moment. Say, God, I repent.
Because that wouldn't have come out if it wasn't in here.
Oh, Jesus, so you are peculiar. You have been purchased. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh has he quickened together with him, having forgiven you of all your trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of the ordinances that were against us, which was contrary to us, and took out of the way, all of it, nailing it to the cross. Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. Not only did he choose us, not only did he make us a peculiar priesthood, not only are we peculiar, glory be to God, but he made a way. He made a way for us, my God, to live a holy life. He paid the price that we could live a holy life. Not on our own, because we could not do it on our own. He had to pay the price. And that was done on Calvary. He made a way that you and I can live a holy life, a life with promise. And that promise is that one day we're going to see him as he is, because we're going to be just like him. A promise. He paid it for us. But then he calls us this. My God, he calls us a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. And that's us. That's us, because we are a purchased people. We have been purchased by the blood of Jesus. We are special in his sight. We are unique in his sight. We need to understand who we are in Christ Jesus. The situation that you're in right now does not dictate the way God feels about you. God loves you, and he has the best for you. But there are times that we have to go through what we have to go through for God to show himself mighty on our behalf. Amen? We have to. We have to go through. But when you have the assurance that even as you are going through, that your God is with you, that he'll never leave you, nor will he forsake you, that he is with you till the end of time. When you have the assurance, my God, that he says these things and his promises, and he is not like man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. If he spoke it, he's going to do it, my God, and he shall bring it to pass. He gave us his word, and the book of Hebrews says, when he could not swear by anything else, he swore by his word. He swore by his word. And he says to us that we are special. We are peculiar, yes, because we have been purchased. But we are chosen, chosen by him, that we can bring forth the glories to him, the one who took us out of darkness and translated us into his marvelous light. That's why we should praise God. That's why we should know who we are. Amen? If you got to look in the mirror every single day and pronounce who you are to yourself until it gets into your spirit, that you are somebody, that you are somebody. You are unique and you are special in the sight of God. Man, I don't care what man thinks about me, and you shouldn't care what man thinks about you. I don't care. I cannot please everybody. No matter how much I would try, I'm not going to be able to please everybody. There's always going to be a naysayer. There's always going to be somebody that has something bad to say about me. Hey, it was that way before I got saved. How much more now that I am saved? How much more? You can't please everybody. You can't. But you got to know who you are. You have to know who you are. You are special in the sight of God. In the sight. In the sight. That means God see you. And it says, the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and that his ears are open unto his cry. The righteous, which is you, when you cry, he hears. You're in his sight. He never leaves you nor forsake you. You're in his sight because you are special. He paid a price for you. He is the Elohim God. He is the creator God. And he created you for such a season as this. I don't know who God was talking to today about your self-esteem, but I hope after this word, your self-esteem has now been brought up. If you got to go home and read these scriptures over and over again until you get it into your scripture, into your spirit, who you are special. You are some special people. Yes, you are. There's different personalities all in here. But we all can blend together into one body, into Christ Jesus. There's nobody the same in here. I have not went through what you went through and vice versa. But we serve the same God, the same God that chose each and every one of us for a purpose, the same God that drew us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen? We all needed a Savior one day, and God heard us. We all needed a Savior. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Bless the name of Jesus. I thank God. I thank God that he chose me. I thank God. I thank God he chose my mom, yeah, my grandma. But I thank God that he chose me. Amen? He could have bypassed me, but he chose me. I thank God for that. That he saw something in me that I don't even see in myself. I thank God for that. Glory to God. I thank God for that. I do. I thank God. Each and every day I thank him for another day. Glory be to God. Another day, my God. That's why I give him the glory and the honor, because I thank him for the day. And the more I learn of Jesus, because I'm ever learning more about him, the more you begin to love him, the more you begin to understand that price that he paid for us. That price that he paid, that was a loving price. A loving price. When I wasn't even loving myself, he was loving on me. But he chose me to be holy, a royal priesthood, a peculiar person, that my praises, my God, could be to him and only him, because it was only Jesus that drew me out of darkness into his marvelous light. It was not man. And it was only Jesus to you. Jesus, Jesus only. Stand to your feet. Jesus, Jesus only. Jesus, Jesus only. Jesus, Jesus only. Glory to God. Shah. My God. We thank Jesus for his word. We thank him. Glory be to God. We thank him for his word. We thank him. We thank him. Father, I thank you for your word today. I thank you, Father, that you love us so much that you have looked past our faults and you have seen our needs and see our needs. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that we are special in your sight, that we may be called many things by man, but you call us special, Father. You call us chosen in a royal priesthood, a holy nation, peculiar people. Father, you just love us despite ourselves. So you send us, my God, just a word today, your word, to remind us that we are special in your sight, that we shouldn't walk around with a hung down head, my God, not realizing who we are in you. We are special. You said in your word today, God, that you have already fought our enemies for us. And we are responsible to put the enemy underfoot because you have already given us the victory. My God, the song was sung in here today, Victory in Jesus. It was just a prelude to what you had to say to your people today, that we are some victorious people in you, that we are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. That God, we should walk with a lifted up head, understanding who we are in you, that we have a heavenly promise, glory be to God, and that we serve the true and the living God. We serve a God that paid a price that he didn't know, that we could have life today and have it more abundantly. We serve a God that said yes to his Father, and took off his, glory be to God, heavenly robe and put on sinful flesh. Walked this earth for 33 and a half years, feeling everything that we would feel, enduring everything that we had to endure, yet he sinned not. Then he laid prostrate on the cross, my God, as a sacrifice. And as he was lifted up, dear God, he says, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. And while he was up there, glory be to God, it was not the nails that held him on the cross. It was the love that he had for you and for myself. Father, we thank you today for the word. Just reminding us, dear God, who we are in Christ Jesus, that we are a special people. Father, we thank you and we bless your name. Give God a hand clap in the house. Oh, come on and give him a hand clap in the house. Come on and open your mouth and give him a blessing in the house. Let him know. It says, show forth the praises of him that drew you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That's what the word says. Show forth your praises. Let him know that you appreciate what he done for you. Let him know that you appreciate what he is doing for you. Let him know you appreciate what he's going to do for you. Glory to God. Glory to God on high. Lord, we thank you. Oh, come on and give him the praise. Now that you know who you are in Christ Jesus, come on and give him the praise. Oh, Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you. Glory to God on high. My God, my God, my God, we bless you.
Ah, Jesus, we bless you. Yes, sir. Okay, and la boshai. Okay, and la beshe. Ooh, yeah. Kararabasi ke adorobo shande. Kete. Ike and la basa katarabo shande. Oh, my God, I thank you. I love you. I praise you. I honor you. I give you the glory. I give you the glory. I give you the glory. I give you the glory, my God. My God, I bless you. Oh, my God. I thank you, Jesus. Just reminding us, God. I was in the house today, downstairs, after I showered and I went in the basement to prepare myself a little more. And God began to show me when I was a little kid. He began to show me some things that I was doing when I was a little kid that was minor things then, but because it wasn't checked, it became major as I grew older. Yeah. And all I could do was begin to praise him because he just showed me, he let me see the things that he brought me out of that I had forgotten. And every now and then, God will show you some of the things that you have forgotten all about, that you counted as nothing, but it meant a lot to God. He will show you, glory be to God, why certain things was happening in your family and why certain things were happening in you that wasn't checked. Oh, but the blood of Jesus. Because he showed me that. Then he let me know about salvation. Shakatarabose. Yay, God. My God, my God. Let me know that it's gone. But it could have been much worse because it went unchecked. Because there was nobody with the spiritual discernment to realize it. They laughed at certain things. And it wasn't funny. It was detrimental. But God. Oh, he will take you back, children of God. He will show you that he was right there. But because you wasn't studying him or studying him, for those of you New Yorkers, he allowed certain things to happen, but it didn't get what I should have got. But he brought me back. So when I read and study his word and share it with you, I'm not just talking what I study, I'm talking what I lived and what I'm living. The admiration and the love that I have for Jesus cannot be compared to anything. There's not enough words in my vocabulary to tell Jesus how much I love him. There's not enough words. So all I can do is serve him to show him that I'm grateful. Because I can't express it out of my mouth. How much I love Jesus. So I have to show him by my work, by what I do, by how I serve him, how I dedicate myself to the craft that he has given me, to the giftings that he has given me. This is my way of showing him that I am grateful. And that should be you. You may not articulate how much you love him, but you can show him by your service. Because your service is a clear indication of how much you love him. That makes sense to you? Well, before I sit down, give God a praise in the house. Now, I'm not talking about no tinsy-wincy praise.
I'm talking about praising the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. I'm talking about praising the Lord of Glory, the great God, the mighty God, the holy God, the only God. Majesty on high. The only true and living God, Jesus Christ. He who has made a way out of no way. Glory to God. You got to love him. Oh, you got to love him. Oh, my God. Let me sit down because I could just, oh, Shatai. Just feel it. I feel it. I feel it. JK and the Lord. Oh, shake. My God. Yes. Yes, my God. Hey, come on. Let it go. Let it go. Come on. Let it go. 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 Glory be to God. Nobody can tell your hallelujah like you can tell your hallelujah. Your hallelujah is contingent upon what God has brought you out of. Your hallelujah is contingent upon the thing, how God made a way for you out of no way. Your hallelujah speaks volumes about you. Glory be to God. The word says in the scripture that the woman praised him much because she was delivered of much. So your praise is a clear indication on how much you was delivered. Or maybe God got to bring you back like he did me this morning and show you, glory to God, that you was a wrench undone. Glory be to God. But he made a way out of no way. He had to show me I was a wrench undone. But the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus. Glory to God. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. I'm finished. Glory to God. I'm finished. Come on.